and I'm really happy to have so many people to welcome to the School of Physics tonight. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Rachel Webster, and Rachel, after postgraduate studies in the universities of Sussex and Cambridge in the UK, went on and took up research positions in Canada before arriving with us in the School of Physics. And since then, she's started off from scratch, really, an astrophysics group, which has become one of the most active and alive research groups in the department. And it's a real asset to the department. Her research interests concentrate on gravitational lensing and large-scale structures of the universe, really quite large-scale things. But tonight she's going to be helping us to think about discovering new planets around other stars. And so could you please join with me in welcoming Rachel Webster tonight?
Well, good evening. It's quite extraordinary to see so many people here tonight. I can only assume that those small robots wandering around on the surface of Mars have created a lot of interest and brought you along to find out a little bit more about the other planets that hopefully we might be exploring before some of you get too old and grey. Okay, well, tonight what I'm going to be doing is, first of all, just briefly talking a little bit about why we might want to find planets around other stars. We're certainly starting to find out something about planets around our own star. Then I'm going to just briefly talk about what a planet is. I don't know if any of you ever thought what distinguishes a planet from a star, but we have some rough idea of exactly what that is. And then, of course, we're going to get on to the meat of the talk, which is figuring out how we go about trying to find planets somewhere well away from our own solar system, and last but not least, actually talk about what we've found. And of course, you can see from the title of the talk that in fact we have found planets around other stars, and I think this is perhaps really ranks as one of the most exciting things that's probably happened in centuries, I think, in human discovery. When I sat down to think about this, although this hasn't really been other solar systems is a whole new world opening up. It is not beyond the bounds of possibility that we can actually go and visit these places. We actually have the technology now, and that funny little robot wandering around scratching the Earth on Mars is showing us that we actually know what to do. So then why do we want to actually find these other planets? Well, there's some sort of basic questions, such as, is our solar system special? Well, clearly what I'm going to be telling you tonight is no, our solar moment. Really, we're working right at the limits of our technology, but with a little bit more effort, we can find hundreds of solar systems, not just the tens we know about already. That, of course, then brings us on to the next really, really interesting question. It's all very well to have lots of rock wandering around stars, but the question is, really, is there life out there? And I'm going to say a little bit more about that later on. We all want to know whether ET is really lurking behind some not too distant star, and indeed whether we can go and visit him before too long. Then there's another question here. What's the process of planet formation? Now this is a bit more of a scientific one, and you might wonder why this would be so interesting, but we're actually on our own planet, we're pushing the boundaries of the physical parameters of our own planet. And one of the things that we need to do, and we need to do fairly urgently, is to understand how our planet came to be as it is. How did the atmosphere come to form? What actually drives the cycles that we rely on to sustain life? You know, the oxygen cycle, the carbon dioxide cycle, and so on. And we believe that by finding and studying other planets, that in fact we're going to learn an awful lot about our own planet. In other words, by studying Mars and studying Venus, we're actually bracketing the Earth in quite a nice way. And then the final one down here is, are we going to colonize these other planets and solar systems? And I think if we actually sit down and start to do the sums, this is not a completely crazy idea. Turns out that economically, it's not terribly difficult to lift stuff off the Earth, to lift a payload off, to lift a person off. We've already done that many, many times. And really, all that's required is, if you like, a political decision to do it. Technologically, this is well within our capabilities. Okay, so where does this story begin? Well, basically, we've got to go back to the Greeks. They were, in fact, the first people who looked up at the skies and discovered that, in fact, there are a small number of heavenly bodies that behaved a little differently from all the rest. Now, these heavenly bodies, in fact, had quite regular patterns of behavior. They weren't doing completely erratic things, but they were definitely moving, whereas most of the remaining stars were fixed in the sky. And the Greeks called these objects planets. Now, very early on, Greek philosophers actually had a pretty good instinctive understanding of the universe. And I've got a couple of quotes here, which I think are pretty good. And these guys, you can see the dates down here. Leucippus, about 500 BC, so that's about 2,500 years ago. And let me just read out what he said. The worlds come into being as follows. Many bodies of all sorts of shapes move from the infinite into a great void. They come together there and they produce a single whirl in which, colliding with one another and revolving in all manner of ways, they begin to separate like to like. Okay, that's a pretty interesting idea, 2,500 years ago. So we've got some notion of swirling, and I want you to keep that in mind when we sort of finally look and see how we think the solar system might have formed. And you note here also the sense that there's not just one world. And if we go on to Epicurus a little later on, he says, there are infinite worlds, both like and unlike this world of ours. For the atoms are infinite in number, and as was already proven, there nowhere exists an obstacle to an infinite number of worlds. Okay, so these guys, 2,500 years ago, presumably without the scientific background we have, are already suggesting that there's tons and tons of worlds out there. But things, of course, didn't remain like this. Those of you who know a little bit about ancient history will know that the mood changed, and you had people like Aristotle coming along a little bit later on, and he said there cannot be more worlds than one. And indeed, this became the prevailing view for a very long time, and in fact, it became even more strangled during the first millennia. Certainly, we believed in, or at least most people came to believe in, what we call a geocentric view, which said that not only was the Earth the center of the universe, but basically we were the only act in the universe, and that nothing else was important. Well, then around the 1500s, a guy called Nicholas Copernicus came along, and he challenged this idea that mankind was at the center of the universe. And by stages since that time, we've been slowly pegging back the story until we've now eventually come the full circle, and we're back where the ancient Greeks would have started us out. Now, the final steps in this process have only happened in the last 2 years. So in other words, we've only detected these new solar systems in the last 2 years. And what I'm going to go on and talk about tonight is exactly how we've gone about doing that. Of course, there have been some people who believed that it was always going to happen, but basically, it's taken us a little time. Let's just start with the sort of quite prosaic stuff, though. What is a planet? And what's the difference between a planet and a star? Well, it's really very, very simple. There's only one thing that matters when we talk about these lumps of matter, and that's mass. Okay? That's the only thing that matters, how big they are. And what we do, or at least what we understand, is that if a body has sufficient mass, then the pressure and temperature at the center of that body will become so great from just the weight of matter pushing down that thermonuclear reactions can occur. Okay, now you might know thermonuclear reactions by another name. This is where you take hydrogen atoms and you fuse them together, form helium atoms. In that process, quite a lot of energy is released, and what you end up with is a very, very hot ball of gas that eventually shines, and of course it shines like a star. Okay? And so that's exactly what a star is. And if there's enough mass, then that's what will happen. And you need, you can see here the terminology I've used, it's 0.08 of the mass of our sun. Okay, this funny little symbol here. This funny little symbol here stands for our sun. Or we could say it's 8% of the mass of our sun. So things quite a lot smaller than our sun can still be stars. What happens, though, if something is smaller than that? It's still going to be made of the same sort of stuff, but will it actually turn into a star? Well, the answer is there's a sort of grey area between about 8% of the mass of the sun and about 1% of the mass of the sun, where sometimes we get a little bit of fusion occurring, and it's between the deuterium atoms, which is a form of hydrogen that's found in a star. So there can be a little bit of fusion happening for these slightly less massive objects, but they don't burn for a long time. So they heat up a little bit, and we call them brown dwarfs. Okay, so what we've got is the real stars up here. We've got kind of got these failed guys here. And then once we get down to about 1% of the mass of the sun, after that, there's nothing going on. Okay, and these are the guys that we call planets. And when we look at a planet, of course, a planet isn't completely cold. It's still got a few things heating it. And in the case of our own planet, the primary thing, I mean, I'm sure most of you know that the interior of our planet is hot. Otherwise, volcanoes, like the spectacular one on Hawaii just recently, wouldn't spew out all that molten lava. So something has to be making it hot. And the primary thing that heats up the center of our planet is radioactivity. So it's still hot, but we're certainly not at a temperature of 2,000 degrees or something like that, which is the temperature we would expect for a small star. Okay, so brown dwarfs, or finding brown dwarfs has been one of the things that astronomers have been trying to do for a couple of decades, and we've just started to be able to do that. These guys are pretty hard to find because they don't shine very brightly. They're very, very dim. And what I want to do is just show you a picture now of one. All these stars have absolutely terrible names. All the stars I'm going to show you tonight have unpronounceable names. I can't pronounce them, and I'll sort of stumble across them. But this one here that I'm going to show you is called Gliese 229b. Okay, the B means it's the companion of Gliese 229. You sort of get the idea. I'm not sure who Gliese was, but the 229 probably means it's a catalogue that Gliese put together. And we sort of get these strange lists of stars. But anyway, people looking at this star found that near it, about 43 AU, which is an astronomical unit, that's just the distance between the Earth and the Sun, so about 43 times the distance of the Earth from the Sun from this star, there was what we call a brown dwarf, and it's got a mass that's somewhere between about 20 and 40 times the mass of Jupiter. So I'm using this little symbol here, MJ, to be the mass of Jupiter. Okay, let's have a look and see a picture of this one. And these brown dwarfs we actually can photograph, particularly when they're quite a long distance away from a star. So here's Gliese 229. And you can see it's a very bright star, or at least it looks very bright, because the guy that we're actually trying to find, this one here, is very faint by comparison. And this here is the brown dwarf. And I want you to sort of take away this, well, at least try and remember this picture, because this gives us an idea of just how hard it is to find these very, very faint objects, either brown dwarfs or planets. They're always near a very, very bright object, and basically they get sort of swamped out by the bright object. This is, actually I should say, this is a Hubble Space Telescope picture, and you can see the resolution is actually much better than is obtained from the ground, where both the brown dwarf and the star have been squished out a bit. Okay, so the sort of task that we have then is to try and find these very faint objects near extremely bright objects. Okay, well, how do we actually go about trying to find these objects? How do we actually try and find planets? Well, there are two basic approaches you can take. The first one is direct imaging, or just actually taking a picture. And that's exactly what I've just showed you for the brown dwarf. You take a picture and you can actually see it there. The second way that we can do it is to use more indirect methods. And when we use an indirect method, we don't actually see the star, but what we do, sorry, we don't actually methods that we've attempted to use. One is, and they've all got long names, of course, but the first one is astrometry. And really what that just means is that we look at a star and we see if it's regularly changing position. I'm going to describe to you a little bit more how this works in just a minute. But so what we're looking to see is whether or not the star is wobbling backwards and forwards. Okay, so that's the astrometry one. Now, the second one is spectroscopy. And most of you, I think, will know that that means that you're actually looking at the spectrum of the star. And this is a little bit more complicated, and that's in fact one that I'm going to talk about in a little bit of detail. But what we're looking at here is actually looking to see if the star is changing velocity in a regular sort of way. In other words, it's moving backwards and forwards like this. So not like that across the line of sight, not changing position, but moving backwards and forwards in the line of sight. Okay, the third one is photometry, and that's just saying, okay, suppose now that we have the face of our star and we've got a little planet going around it, the little planet star, and when it actually goes across the face of the star, we'll actually block out some light from the star, so the star will get a little fainter for a moment, and then it will get brighter again when the planet passes right across the face. So that's a change in brightness. And the final one, which I'm not actually going to talk about at all, is something called gravitational lensing, and I have talked about gravitational lensing before, but this is... It works, but it doesn't find us planets that we can actually go and study afterwards. So what we're concentrating on tonight is trying to find planets that we can actually go back and study later on, and the lensing is not very good for that. Okay, well, let's just have a look then at the direct imaging method, and we'll sort of see how that works. The main problem with trying to do or to use this direct imaging method, I mean, obviously this is easily the best. You just want to go out and take a picky and say, hey, there's a planet, and so on. But of course, you've got to be able to see these jolly planets. And the problem is that they're very, very faint and they're very close to a bright star. Okay, very faint, very close to a bright star. And I'm sure you know about this sort of problem. If you go somewhere and you look at something that's incredibly bright, it is very difficult to see something very faint. Your eye automatically adapts to the very bright thing and then it becomes the faint thing. And the idea is exactly the same when we as astronomers go looking near a very bright star for something very faint. Our detectors get completely saturated by the star and then we can't see the faint thing. And if, don't worry too much about this, we'll skip over that. I've got some other equations that we can have a look at later. But the important thing that I want you to take away here is that if we look in optical light, and that's the light, of course, that we see with our eyes, then Jupiter is about 1 billion times fainter than the Sun. So this is just to give you some idea of how hard this problem is. It's about 1 billion times fainter than the Sun. So that's the sort of contrast that we've got to be able to deal with. If we go to other wavelengths, the ratio gets a little bit better. And so, for example, if we go out into the infrared, Jupiter is only about 10,000 times fainter than the Sun. So that's a bit better, but it's still a pretty horrible problem. Now, so that's one of the problems. That's the contrast problem for direct imaging. And we haven't really figured out a smart way of solving that problem yet. The other problem, though, is resolution. Most of these planets are actually very, very close to the star. Okay? And it's just a question of the resolving power of the telescope that we use. So, for example, with the Hubble Space Telescope, which is easily our best telescope, we can resolve at about 1/20th of an arc second. Now, that's actually an incredibly small angle, okay, except when you come looking for planets. Okay, 1/20th of an arc second. So you've got to imagine, you know, you're taking... you know, half the globe, that's 180 degrees, okay? And then you're going to take one of those degrees, you're going to divide that by nearly 4,000, and that's 1 arc second. And then we're going to divide it by 20 again to get down to what the Hubble Space Telescope can see. It's a very, very fine resolution, okay? But if we wanted to see Jupiter near the Sun from about 32 light years away, which is about the distance of the nearest, 100 stars or so, then we'd need to do about 100 times better than that. Okay, we'd need to do about 100 times better than the Space Telescope. So you can see it's pretty hopeless. I mean, the Hubble's the best we've got, and even that doesn't go anywhere near finding us a planet. Okay, so what are we going to do? We've got to try one of these indirect methods. And I don't really have time tonight to go through all of the indirect methods, so what I'm going to do is concentrate on the one that works. I mean, after all, that makes the best sense, doesn't it? Okay, so let's look at the spectroscopy. Of course, it's the most complicated one to explain as well. But anyway, let's have a go at it and see how we go. We've got to, you know, this is a physics lecture, so, you know, there's got to be a few physics ideas in here. So here we go. This is all the physics that we're going to do tonight. So let's start with the first idea that we're going to need to sort of understand what's going on here. And that's the idea of center of mass. Now, really all this means is that if I've got two bodies, then there's a point somewhere between them which effectively acts as the centre of mass. Now, the concept is really a very familiar one to you. If you've ever seesawed with one of your friends in the playground, which I'm sure you have, and you know that basically if you balance it somewhere in the middle, then you can get a pretty good seesaw, and that's fine. Now, of course, if you've got children, or if you're aberrant enough to babysit your friend's children, then you'll know that there's a problem when you go to the playground. You put this little kid on the end, and then you hop on the other end of the seesaw. It's a complete mess, isn't it? And so what you have to do is you actually have to adjust where you balance the thing. Now let's see if I can get this right. Nearly got it. Okay, so I've put a little bit of blue tack on the end there, so I've changed the weight on one end, and I can still find the point up there, and that's the centre of mass of the system now. And you'll see that what's happened is I've put more mass here, and I've shortened this arm, I've kept the mass here the same, and that I've had to lengthen that arm to balance it out. And it's exactly the same sort of idea that we need with our star and our planet. Okay? And you can see I've got a little equation there, and the equation's quite a simple one. You just take the mass of the star times the distance between the centre of mass and the star, and that's got to be equal to the mass of the planet and the distance between the centre of mass and the planet. So what it basically says is if this is big and this is small, then this has got to be big and this has got to be small for the equation to work. Okay? So the centre of mass is going to be very near the massive object. Okay, well, we're worried about Sun-Jupiter system, so what happens in that case? Okay, well, if we look at the Sun-Jupiter system, you can easily work out where the centre of mass between those two objects is, and it turns out to be approximately at the surface of the Sun. So we've got a little diagram here. Okay, there's the Sun. Okay, there's Jupiter. And we're letting them both go around in nice circular orbits. And this little cross here is the centre of mass of this system. And this is where the important thing comes into play now. Once we work out the centre of mass of that system, the important thing is, and you may not be fully conscious of this, but both of these objects effectively orbit that centre of mass. Okay, so the Sun is going around the centre of mass, and Jupiter is going around the centre of mass. Okay, so if we look at this system from outside, somewhere over here, then we see both the star moving and the planet moving. Now, of course, the planet's moving a hell of a lot more than the star is because of that ratio that we just looked at, the seesaw ratio. Because it's a lot lighter, it's got to balance off against the mass of the star. But the star is still moving around the centre of mass. And it's that movement that we're going to try and detect with our spectroscopy. Okay, so that's the first idea, okay, that we have to have this, we have the centre of mass, and both the star and the planet are moving around the centre of mass. Okay, well, if they're moving around the centre of mass, then that means that not only the planet, which is hard to see, but that the star also has a regular velocity backwards and forwards. Okay? We'll call it its orbital velocity. And that brings us to, and we can actually write down that velocity in terms of the physical parameters of the system. Now, I could have gone through and worried you by deriving all of these equations, but it's just simple orbital motion, and these equations are not terribly hard to find. But what we can do is we can work out that the velocity of the star in kilometres per second goes like 30 times the mass of the planet. There's a sine I in here, and this is just, I'll talk about that in just a minute, and then it's divided by some power the mass of the star and the period of the star. So basically all the orbital parameters of the system feed into the velocity that we expect to see for this star. So what's this sign I? Well, unfortunately, not all the orbits that we're going to see are going to be nicely placed on the sky like this. In other words, we're not always going to see our star with the planet going around it. Things are randomly oriented in the sky, and so sometimes the star might be here and the planet might be going around in your line of sight. Okay? And sometimes it might be at an angle somewhere in between. And that sign I is the thing that it's that unknown angle of inclination there. Okay, well, we've got our star moving. And what's the final step in the process? Well, the crucial thing here is, remember, the star's easy to see, the planet's hard to see, and what we can now do is we can actually look at the planet, at the star, and see that it's moving. And we do that using something called Doppler shift. Okay, so how does Doppler shift work? Well, the important thing here is that you have to have some feature in the spectrum of the star that you can recognize. And there are plenty of those, so that's not a problem. And then what happens is that as the star moves, basically the velocity of the star changes, and as the velocity changes, the wavelength of that feature moves backwards and forwards. Now, it's a lot easier to understand the idea of Doppler shift if we actually take a very familiar example. And that's what I'm going to do here. This little box, you can see, this is probably the most used demonstration in the School of Physics, I think. You'll see that it's kind of battered, and in the moment I think you'll see why, I'm feeling that some of my colleagues aren't terribly adept at using it, and they occasionally let go and have it flying across the room. Anyway, it's pretty battered, and in fact, it's not even very glamorous. I, in fact, had to give a talk like this in Parliament . But anyway, let's see how this works. What we're going to do is we're going to look at Doppler shift for sound rather than light, and it works in exactly the same way. Now, sound has got a wavelength, and basically what we're going to do is it's got a tone here. That's great. Okay. It's got a tone, and when this moves, the tone is actually going to change. It's either going to go higher or it's going to go lower. And this is a very familiar thing for you because, you know, when an ambulance goes by, you know, when it comes towards you, it sort of goes and rises, and then when it goes away, you know, it immediately drops and as it goes away. Okay? So it's the rise as it comes towards you and then the drop as it goes away from you. So let's just have a look and see how this works. Now, so this is exactly the same idea that we're looking at with these stars as they orbit around the centre of mass, except we're looking in light instead of sound. And it's called Doppler shift, and it's a very sort of simple idea. Okay, I've got a little diagram here, so you can just look at it pictorically. And what you see here is, this is our little astronomer down here with their telescope. Here's the centre of mass of our system, and here's the star, okay, which is going around in its orbit, and as it comes towards the telescope, the wavelength gets shorter, and we usually call this a blue shift, because blue light has a shorter wavelength, and then as it goes away, it gets longer, okay, as it's going over here, and we call that red shift. And so it's the measurement of this Doppler shift that's going to tell us that the star is wobbling, and it's wobbling because of this planet here, okay, which has moved the centre of mass from the centre of the star somewhere towards the planet. Okay, well, I can show you all sorts of diagrams of this. The idea at this stage, you probably noticed us fooling around with the computers at the beginning of the lecture. You know, lectures are the bane of my life. Oh, sorry, computers are the bane of my lectures. I'll get this. Anyway, basically what I wanted to do, was to actually log in to a very nice little JavaScript that runs at Cornell University in the States. Unfortunately, it's sort of proprietary, so I can't download it, so I have to use it online. And also, unfortunately, the trusty computer in this lecture theatre that isn't Java-enabled. So we weren't actually able to get it up and running despite the fact that we stole a computer from somewhere else and tried to do it on the fly. But for those of you that have a pen and paper and are Java-enabled at home, if you want to scribble down that address and go in and have a look at it, this is a beautiful simulation of a binary system. And basically, what it does, what I'm going to show you on this transparency in real time, and allows you to adjust all the parameters of your binary system so that you can actually see exactly what it is that you would measure. So it's a very sexy little demonstration. But this is the picture version of it, the one that doesn't actually work as you push the buttons. And you can see here that what you've got are two things orbiting each other. Okay, these are in different configurations. You're taking a spectrum, and the lines here are just supposed to show you that it's a feature in the spectrum. And you can see here, A is coming towards us, and so it's blue shifted. B is going away, so it's red shifted. So they're separated. At this point here, they're both, neither of them are traveling either towards us or away from us, so the feature's in the same place. Then they swap over, and the feature's reverse, and so on. And you can actually see this in the little simulation in a very neat sort of way. Okay, well, that's the idea then that we use to try and measure whether or not a star has a little planet around it. Let's just have a look at some numbers and see how hard this is going to be. Okay, suppose that we want to go and search around a solar type star, so it's a star just like our sun, and we want to go looking for Jupiter's, because we're going to start off looking for the most massive planet, because obviously that's going to be easier to find. Well, Jupiter is about 1,000th the mass of the sun, and let's go looking at a Jupiter that's at about the same distance as Jupiter is, because it looks like that's a good place to look. So that's about five times the distance between the Earth and the Sun. So what sort of velocity do we expect to see on our star? Well, this is quite an easy little calculation to do with that formula I wrote down before, and it turns out that the velocity of the star, because remember it's only the star that we can see, is going to be 13 meters per second. Well, you know, 13 meters per second is still quite quick. You know, if you're trying to run that fast, you know, it's a good deal faster than people run. Well, it's not a good deal faster, it's a bit faster than people run. But astronomically speaking, that's a very, very difficult measurement to make. Up until the time people start to do these calculations, we thought a measurement of 1,000 meters per second was a really good measurement. That was the best that we were generally able to do. So now these planet guys come along and they want to do 13. And just to show you how hard the calculation can get, if we wanted to find something as little as the Earth rather than as big as Jupiter, we'd need to do 6 centimetres a second. Okay, 6 centimetres a second. So that's what we're sort of trying to shoot for. And, okay, let's just plunge on then. I've got some numbers here also if we wanted to do some of those other indirect methods, but let's just stick to the spectroscopy for the moment. Okay, well, so what's changed and why suddenly are we able to find planets? Well, the limitation in doing this experiment has always been in being able to calibrate the wave. Obviously, if we want to see if the wavelengths change, we've got to be able to reference it to something. And we've got to be able to do that with a great deal of accuracy if we're going to be able to measure velocities of 13 metres per second. And what the astronomers who are doing these measurements have done is to develop a completely new technique which actually puts an iodine cell, an iodine absorption cell, in the light path that comes from the star as it passes through the telescope before it gets to the spectrograph. And what that does is it allows us to put the spectrum of the iodine on top of the spectrum of the star, and that enables us to do a very, very accurate wavelength calibration. Okay, so it's a very sort of sneaky little addition to the sort of stuff that we've always done. Previously, what we would have done is to basically switch another light source into the path or something like that. That's a standard way of calibrating. But what they actually do here is they put the iodine cell in the light path and actually lay the iodine absorption spectrum on top of the stellar spectrum. And what they're able to do is to measure 3 meters a second. Okay, so this is now looking extremely promising because the number I mentioned earlier was 13 meters a second. That was what we were sort of targeting, and they were, with this technique, they could get 3 meters a second. And just to give you some idea, that's about 1,000th of the a pixel size on the CCD. So they're able to measure the wavelength accuracy to 1,000th of the size that they're actually recording photons in. So those of you who know anything about these sort of measurements, it's a very, very impressive sort of measurement to make. Now, one of the caveats on these searches now is remember that what we're doing is we're looking for that sinusoidal movement of the star, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards. And so clearly we have to look at the star long enough for it to go backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards. In other words, we have to know the orbital period. Jupiter takes 12 years to go around the sun. And so if we're going to look for something the size of Jupiter at the distance of Jupiter, that's a 12-year experiment, which is quite a long time. In fact, it's a very long time. And so that makes it quite a difficult experiment to do. But as you're going to see, it turned out that a lot of our presuppositions were not in fact accurate, and we're doing it a lot faster than 12 years. Now, the final thing about these searches is that we only look at certain types of stars. I'm not sure how familiar you all are with stars, but stars actually come in lots of different flavors. O, B, A, F, G, K, N, so on. Okay, and these flavors tell you something about the mass of the star, in fact. Okay, just as we were talking before about the mass being the distinguishing thing between stars and planets, so it distinguishes different types of stars. And if your star is very, very massive, then it turns out it has a very, very short lifetime. And in fact, it's not long enough, really, for planets to do anything interesting. And so what we do is we confine the searches for these planets to stars that have pretty long lifetimes, like our own sun. Think stars that are going to last about 10 billion years or more. Okay, so what's happened? Well, success. And there are probably about 4 or 5 groups, actually, in the world now who are successfully doing this. But I'm only going to really mention two groups, Mayer and Quiloz, the Swiss, who actually were the first guys who made the detection. And that was October of 1995. So it really is a very, very new measurement. But Marcy and Butler had been working on this problem for about 8 or 10 years at that stage, and they were actually able to confirm the measurements of Mayer and Quiloz within the week, okay, because they had a system that was up and running. Since that time, Marcy and Butler have in fact found nearly all the remaining instances of planets. And so these guys here, who are from San Francisco State University, have most of the detections under their belts. They've currently looked at, or they're looking at, about 400 stars in the northern sky. And as I said to you, remember that you can't detect a planet if you look at it for long enough to see the sinusoidal variation. So if you've only looked at it for 5 years, you can't detect a Jupiter-sized thing at 5 AUs, because it takes 12 years to do it. And so there's still going to be more planets around some of these stars, okay? They just haven't looked at them for long enough yet. Okay, but the results I'm showing you are stuff from those 400 stars. One of the really exciting things, I think, is that Paul Butler, who you'll see is half of this team, is just about to start work at the Anglo-Australian Observatory in Sydney, and he's going to be using the Anglo-Australian telescope to do a southern survey for planets around southern stars. And the promise of the work that Paul can do will probably be even better than the stuff that's done in the north, because we have an even better spectrograph on that telescope. So you can sort of sit around and wait, but it looks like we're going to have quite a massive planetary program coming out of Australia shortly. And what I'm going to show you are the results of the latest planet that's been discovered. And I told you that these stars have rotten names. So here's this one, Rho Coronae Borealis, okay? Or it's often just called Rho CRB. And let's just have a look and see the sort of data that these guys get when they find a planet around one of these stars. Now this one's a dead cert. There's no problems identifying this star as having a planet around it. And up the top here, what you see is the difference in the velocity of the star over a period of time. So we've got time measured along this axis here, okay, and we've got the velocity difference just measured using the Doppler effect, okay, up on this axis here. And you'll see that these are all the data points that have been measured. And there's a dotted line that's sort of been tentatively fitted through those data points. And then what they do is they basically fold all of these sinusoidal variations up into one, okay? And you get the thing down the bottom here, which is essentially one e-fold or one sort of e-folding thing of the orbit of that particular star. And that allows you to very precisely define both the period for the star, which is from one trough, the bottom of one trough to the bottom of the next trough or whatever, and also the height of the peak in the sinusoidal variation. And for each of the planets that's been discovered, the data basically looks the same. For this particular guy, the period is about 40 days, so it's oscillating every 40 days. Compare that to 12 years for Jupiter, and this is where the really interesting stuff is coming. This variation here is about 67 meters a second, and remember the accuracy is 3 meters a second, so it's an easy detection. In this particular case, the orbit is almost completely circular, and the mass of the planet is about the same as the mass of Jupiter. Okay, so it's a Jupiter-sized mass orbiting in a circular orbit, but it's way, way closer in than Jupiter is. It's actually at about a quarter the distance between the Earth and the Sun. Okay, so it's very close. In fact, it's even closer in than Mercury. Okay, so it's a very, very different sort of system. Okay, so that's one particular example. What have we found overall? Well, we've actually, and I'm just going to sort of, there's a little slight detour here. We've actually found some planets around pulsars as well, which I'll say something about in a moment. And then we've found nine examples of planets around other stars where the masses are something less than about 10 Jupiter masses. So nine examples of that. This is what I said, there are just plenty of these. And then there are 11 examples now of those brown dwarfs that I showed you a picture of at the beginning, and there are two of these pulsar planetary systems. Okay, well, let's just have a look at some of this data. I'm just going to show you the pulsar stuff because this is a bit of a red herring, but it's actually rather interesting, so let's just throw it up here for a moment. Pulsars, as I'm sure some of you know, are very high-precision clocks. They send out a regular beat every second or every tenth of a second or something like that. Now, because they're such regular and precise clocks, it makes them very, very good things to measure this Doppler shift on. Okay, so you can do it incredibly accurately. And sort of almost fortuitously, you don't really expect to find planets around pulsars, because pulsars are stars that are basically blown up. They've gone supernova. And so you might expect that if there ever had been a planet there, it would have been blasted to smithereens when the star went supernova. So when people actually found planets around these, it was somewhat surprising. But what we now think is that these planets around the pulsars, and there are two cases now where they've been found, are not actually the sort of planets that we love, which are ones that have sort of grown up with the star and evolved with the star. These are actually planets that were probably born after the supernova event. So they're bits of junk and rubbish that somehow got left from the supernova explosion and have been left orbiting the pulsar. But the neat thing about these pulsar planets is that they can actually measure much smaller masses than we can currently with the Doppler, the other Doppler technique. So this is just to give you an example. This is the little pulsar planet here. This is our sun. There's Mercury, Venus and Earth, and this is a drawing to scale and with the sizes actually accurately shown. So that's Earth, Venus, Mercury. And in this particular case, there's the pulsar. It's got three planets around it, and you can see all of them are inside Venus's orbit, and two of them are about the same size as Earth and Venus. Okay? And because this pulsar is such an accurate clock, you can actually do a much more precise Doppler measurement than you can using a conventional star. So that's one example. But those sort of planets are most unlikely to have life on them, and they're certainly most unlikely to be places where you'd want to go for your holidays. Now, the planets around the normal stars look a little bit different. So let's have a look at these. This is the table as it stands at the moment, except it doesn't have that last one on that I just showed you. And basically, these are the stars up here, and they're mostly pretty much like our sun, about one solar mass. And of course, here's the prototype up here, that's us, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars. And you can see these are the names of the stars down here, which have had planets discovered around them. And I'm not going to attempt to pronounce them all, but you can see they're all Butte names. And here are the planets now. And these are all to scale, right? So, and they're all in terms of Jupiter-sized masses. So there's one guy here that kind of looks a little bit like us. So there's about two Jupiter masses, and it's about two AUs, so it's a bit further out than Mars, so that looks a bit like our solar system. But these guys here are really quite unexpected. Here we are, half the size of Jupiter, nearly the size of Jupiter, four times the size of Jupiter, half the size of Jupiter, and look at the distances from the star. They're inside the orbit of Mercury. So you've got these huge, massive planets orbiting very, very close into the star. Here's another couple of beauties here, six times the mass of Jupiter, 10 times the mass of Jupiter, and they're orbiting inside the Venus, inside the radius of Venus. So you can see these were not the results that we expected. Okay, we didn't expect to find these big planets orbiting so close in. Well, let's just sort of summarise a little bit of what we thought we were going to get and what we actually got. Now remember, this is not the last word on the story, because we've only been looking for these planets for perhaps 5 or 6 years. And so we can only find the planets that are close in at the moment. The guys that are further out take longer to do their orbit, and so we wouldn't have found them yet. So this is probably not the whole story at all. But this bit of the story is jolly interesting, and it certainly gives us something to think about. So, got the two little columns here, what we thought we were looking for, and then what we got, okay? So we thought that there would probably be planetary systems around about 30% of stars. At the moment, we're running at about 3%, okay? We thought that there would be many planets around the stars. At the moment, we can only detect one planet, and that's simply because we don't have the sensitivity. There may well be many planets around these stars, but so far we can only pick up the big guys, the Jupiter-like guys. We thought that planets were had this constant spacing. Some of you might have heard of the Titus-Bode law that tells you that there's a sort of regular spacing of planets. We have no idea at this stage, really, what it's going to look like, but certainly planets are much closer in than we expected to find them. Okay. We thought that there would be giant planets about the same mass as Jupiter. Well, some of them had masses much, much greater than Jupiter. Okay, we thought that these big planets would be located a fair way out, And this is perhaps one of the really big surprises. There are two very, very difficult things to understand here. We thought that they'd be about 5 AU, and what we're finding are these huge planets that are very, very close in. And it's very difficult to understand how you could actually form a planet that close in. And the reason is quite simple. Basically, you expect that the star, that the last material away from the inner regions of the solar system, it's very hot, okay? It will certainly melt anything, any ices or anything like that. And so you don't actually expect to get these very big and certainly these can't be icy planets forming very, very close into the star. So this one is going to require a little bit of thought. The sorts of ideas people are suggesting at the moment are that these big planets in fact form much, much further out, and then for some reason they end up spiralling in towards the planet, although the mechanisms for doing that are still being hotly debated. We expected the planets to all be on circular orbits and all to have very sort of what we call low inclinations. And the reason for that is based around our ideas of how we think solar systems fall. I'm going to show you something on that in just a moment. But the basic thought is that you've got a disk of gas and dust, okay, and you get little lumps and bumps of material forming and accreting in that disk, and they grow over time so that the lumps get larger and larger and larger, and then eventually they grow into a planet. Now, if that happens, the lumps as they grow are actually in a gas and dust disk. And what that means is that they are going to experience drag, okay? And that will tend to keep them in nice circular orbits. And so some of these planets have very highly eccentric orbits, and that's very difficult to understand. Okay, well, we're sort of running out of time just a little bit, and so I'm going to move a little bit faster on these last few things. Let's just have a quick look at the formation of the solar system. So far, most of what we're seeing fits with our ideas about the formation of the solar system. We think that our solar system formed from a dusty disk around stars, and we'll have a quick look at some slides because we're now seeing these dusty disks around stars from the Hubble Space Telescope. So we know that bit was definitely correct. Let's just knock the lights down a little bit. This is one of the pictures from the Hubble Space Telescope. This is a star called Beta Centaurus, and the star has actually been blocked out so that it doesn't put a lot of light onto the detector. And what you can see is that there's a disk-like structure around this star. Now, this isn't the only star which we think we see a disk-like structure around. If you look at these guys here, you see these are four examples. This little dark thing here, we think, is another one of these little disks around the star here. There's another star with a disk around it, and so on. Okay, and we think that these are the beginnings of little solar systems. Here's a couple that are side on. Okay, so you can see the dark disk here, and you can just see the star poking out the edge here. Here's one that's a little bit more obvious, a little bit more face on, and you can see the dark disk here. And then finally, this is these are actually young stars which show jets, but you can see that the jet is actually coming from a system that has presumably a bright star in behind here, and here's a dark, dusty disk that's rotating around the star. So what you've got are these disks forming around the stars, and so it seems that our idea of disks around stars as an early part of the process is pretty good. That seems fine. We can actually now do computer simulations to actually produce these planetesimals and planets. We can actually put the physics in, and we can get pretty good results. And this is just a color transparency. You can see the stars in the middle here, and you can see the gas and dust, the whirling gas and dust, as we heard from our ancient Greeks. This is how the solar system formed, and we can actually do numerical simulations now on big computers that do in fact form solar systems. And of course what we can then do is we can make observations of the planetary systems that we see and feed those back into the models then, and try and make these models produce the sort of Jupiter-sized planets that we see very, very close in. Okay, well, what's the prognosis then for the future? Well, the first thing is, and I think I can sort of quite categorically say, there definitely are other solar systems out there, and there are probably a lot of them. We're, with these Doppler shift observations, we're reaching the limit of our existing technology. And if we want to go the next step, then we're going to have to do some rather more exciting things. So, for example, one sort of possibility is to put up something like the Kepler mission, which is one of the new satellites that's been proposed, which will go out and search for habitable planets. So it'll be a satellite dedicated to doing this. And the idea here is to search for Earth-sized planets, and you want to search for Earth-sized planets because you know an Earth-sized planet is the sort of place where you might find life. An Earth-sized planet can't just be made of hydrogen, okay? Because particularly if it's close into the star, because hydrogen is too light and will just escape from that star. So if you see an Earth-sized planet fairly close to a star, then it's got to have a nice solid surface like Mars and like Earth, and that provides you with a habitable or potentially habitable planet. If you can then find the ones that are in what we call the habitable zone, and that's where liquid water exists, then you've got a very good chance that those are the planets on which life might have evolved. And so this is one particular mission that's been proposed to NASA. NASA didn't like it, so they haven't yet funded it, although I suspect after all the enthusiasm for the Mars mission, a mission like the Kepler mission is likely to be selected in the next few years. It may not be this one, but something like it. Okay, so those are the next steps in the search. Of course, I think one of the ultimate aims probably has to be to find life out there. I'm not sure quite what form the life's going to be in. I was quite interested to come across this particular option. I was particularly interested that it was Venus, because I'm sure most of you know it's a rather inhospitable location, but there you go. And finally, just to finish up on, again, those of you who are online, if you are interested in staying up to date with the current search for planets, this particular website is in fact the best one. This is the Marcy and Butler website at San Francisco State University, and they always have the latest stuff directly online. Okay, well, I think we've run out of time, so thank you. Several planets, in fact, may well be affecting all of these stars. Okay, what we've simply assumed here is that the biggest planet is making the biggest effect, and that's essentially the sort of idea that we have in our own solar system. But if there were two planets, for example, that were spaced at different radii, they would put two different sinusoidal perturbations onto the star, and which would basically just add up. Okay, and And so that would be actually quite easy to detect. And in fact, that's what they were able to detect in the case of the pulsar. You can actually see sort of three different sinusoidal variations, all with different wavelengths, okay, or periods, sort of superimposed on top of each other. But at the moment, basically, all we can do is detect the big ones, okay? That's the crucial thing. Oh yeah, every observation that we make has that in it, right? And we know about that, and we know that to an incredible degree of accuracy. So we can take that out. They did, yeah. Obviously, when you get a sort of radical suggestion like this, it's very important that it's, you know, people hit it as hard as possible and question it as strongly as possible. And what has been suggested is that there are some not sort of rather strange oscillations in the atmospheres of the stars that are actually creating the Doppler shift rather than a planet that's orbiting it. It turns out that that suggestion might just have held water for one of the cases, okay, which was the first one discovered. It's completely untenable in the other eight or so cases. And one of the reasons for that is that whenever a star actually pulsates at all, it actually changes in brightness along with the change in, you know, the pulsation. And that's because it's changing area, okay? And they have very, very accurate measurements of the brightness of these stars, and so they're actually able to rule out that suggestion. But it was a good suggestion that had to be looked at. Yeah.
But it'd be fair enough to say the 400 stars that we've looked at, we haven't seen anything that could be a planet like the Earth or in the area of the Earth. So, on a non-spiritual side, could you make any comments like we may be the only planet is
habitable.
I mean, look, 400
looks, yeah, it's in my head. Okay. Non-spiritual,
I'm not talking about.
Yeah. One of the things I wanted to try and stress was we're at a very early stage looking for these planets so far. And we're at a very, very early stage. So we haven't really, for some of these planets, we haven't really looked for long enough to be sure that there aren't other planets. About that, quite a lot of the orbits are quite highly eccentric, okay. And how do we know that?
Yeah.
Well, because when you fit those curves that I showed you, right, I sort of said they were nice clean sinusoids. Well, they are. It's a circular orbit, but it's not a circular orbit, and you get all sorts of funny shapes. And so they've actually been able to work, work out some of those curves. Quite a lot of detail, and they're definitely highly eccentric. Now, that's definitely a problem, okay, for the theories of formation, because we would naturally I don't think this is a very good transparency. I sort of fought a bit with the computer on this one. But anyway, this plot is the spectrum of the different planets that we know. So this is Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, Earth, and Venus. And the point here is that you can actually look at the spectrum of the planet and you can see something about the constituents here. And what you can see for Earth is that it's got all these features that are due to oxygen that actually show up in the spectrum. Okay? Whereas if you look at Venus up here, you can see features due to carbon dioxide and hydrosulfic acid, which we know are the main things in the atmosphere there. So when we get to the point where we can actually find these planets, if we can then figure out how to get a spectrum of them without the star getting in the way, then we can actually tell whether or not there's oxygen there. And you're absolutely right. You want to go looking for the guys with oxygen, because that tells you that if it's a life form that's like us, then that's where it'll be.
The gas giants that are some of the gas giants.
Well, yeah. Well, they couldn't. So they can't really be gas giants like Jupiter because the escape velocities at that distance. I mean, essentially, if you have an atmosphere around a planet, right, then there are two things that hold the atmosphere, and Jupiter is just one big atmosphere, basically. Just happen to have a transparency here. Okay, and you've got these two effects. You've got gravity trying to hold the atmosphere down, but then as it gets hotter, temperature, you know, obviously makes the molecules move faster and they can escape the gravity. Okay, so you've got this tension between gravity and temperature. So if you take something like Jupiter and you move it in close at a very high temperature, then you can get to a point where hydrogen can escape. Okay, and in fact that's quite an, well, you see, hydrogen can certainly escape off the Earth, okay, because we don't have a hydrogen atmosphere, and that's what's shown on this diagram here. We lose hydrogen, but we keep carbon dioxide. Okay, so there's this tension, and it is a problem for having gas giants in close into the sun. So the composition of those things is clearly not quite as we expected. Yeah, well, I mean, we're doing all of this, you know, on a long lever at the moment. You know, we're deducing all of this from what we know here. It may be that they are in fact fairly gas rich and they're not spending very much time there. They may be on plummeting orbits of some sort, you know, being driven in on fairly short timescales. So we can't be sure at this stage that we really know what we're talking about. Okay. Good question. I think there was. It's very interesting now to hear the Americans, because obviously they've driven a lot of the space exploration, well, along with the Russians, talking about this. The American scientists, the space race from the mid 50s, you know, through to the late 70s was really driven by these two countries trying to show off against each other, and when it no longer became necessary to show off, basically politically, they shut the program down. I mean, that's essentially what's happened. The fascinating thing is that there was, the technology was all sitting there. It was something we could easily do. And, you know, for 20 years or so, we haven't put a man on the moon because somebody decided that we weren't going to do it anymore. I think I'm inclined to believe now that this is a rather short-sighted thing to have decided, and that it's perhaps time to start revisiting actually going out and taking a much more proactive attitude to space exploration. I think, though, it's going to be at a much lower cost than it was last time. It was a very expensive program, and I think it can be done very cheaply now. And so it just remains for people like you to get good engineering degrees or whatever and just make it happen. Oh, the binary systems that we've always found in the past are much, much, they're hundreds and hundreds of AU apart. They're nothing like this close. So yes, there is quite a fundamental difference.
We have beautiful photos of the Hubble telescope, which you said was our best telescope.
For resolution, yes.
Has anyone worked out what sort of size telescope, if we got back to the moon, would give us fantastic results from the moon? Because, you know, we've got the Anglo Australians, I think we had something like that on the moon, would we be miles better than Hubble?
Something like that on the moon would be better than Hubble. But you wouldn't build the Anglo-Australian telescope on the moon. You'd do something much smarter than that. Hubble's actually quite a small telescope. You know, it's only about 2.5 metres. By going to the moon, you get lots of advantages. You could do interferometry, for example, and we're almost getting to the stage where we can do interferometry at optical wavelengths, and so you might be able to set up an array of optical telescopes and get superb resolution in the optical that we just haven't dreamed of before. There are a number of astronomers in the States who believe that we should be pushing, who actively think about and work, try and work out how we might put a base on the moon. And if we did that, it wouldn't just be a scientific base. It would probably be driven by economic requirements. There's a lot of thought being given now to energy generation in space, mining, all sorts of other activities, which are starting to look not implausible. So that would be what would drive it. And the scientists would piggyback as usual.